Judy, do you want to announce the guest? God is still speaking, and I behold the light and love of God within you, each of you. Today is the 20th Sunday after Pentecost. Today is October the 6th, and we're with Reverend John Hawk. And John, it's an honor to stand with you today and serve. And I'm just so happy to be with everyone today. Our mission is to feed the hungry, body, mind, and spirit. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here at First Congregational Church. And we do have some announcements today. I would like to start out with Judy Giblin this morning.
Good morning. Jazz Vespers starts this month, next Sunday. We have Rob Weinberger and his group coming. And Rob is a consummate professional, and he has a very good group of people with him. So you could find your way clear to come over and listen at 5 o'clock. And next Sunday, I'll be asking for help moving things up here, but that's next Sunday. And so just wanted to let you know that we're back again.
Today is World Communion Day. It also is Happy Birthday Sunday and Friendship Sunday. And for those of you who haven't joined us perhaps before, after the service, we will have fellowship in the parlor with a very special cake where we can continue in fellowship and worship with each other. The first announcement today is actually Neighbors in Need. And if you would hold Douglas Gardner and Judy in your prayers, Douglas would have given this announcement this morning. There's an envelope in your bulletin in regards to Neighbors in Need. And it's a UCC offering. One third of the offering supports Council for American Indian Ministry. Two thirds are used by Justice and Witness Ministries to provide grants to UCC churches and organizations and to support a variety of justice initiatives, advocacy efforts, and direct service projects. This year's theme is Mental Health Justice for All, and please make your offering in the basket during offering time. And also next Sunday is our Super Salad Sunday. Bring a fun salad or delicious salad or deviled eggs. And we will partake of Super Salads next Sunday, and you can sign up for the drawing. There will be a drawing for a $25 gift card in December. And this is sponsored by the Faith Community Connection. The next Food for the Soul will take place on Wednesday, October 16th, from 12:30 to 2 p.m. in the parlor. You bring a story, a poem, memorabilia, a photo, or another item, and we share it around food, and we get to feed our souls, actually. This coming Food for the Soul was inspired actually by Mary Cutterback and Phyllis Martin, and its theme is Gifts of Joy. So that's October the 16th. Beverages and desserts are provided by Faith Community Connection. On Tuesday, October the 29th, the Faith Community Connection is hosting a trunk or treat in our parking lot if you would like to help provide a safe place for our community of children to trick-or-treat. Sign up at the welcome desk. You can decorate your vehicle's trunk, or like I'm doing with no car at the present moment, decorating a table. Hand out or donate candy or volunteer with preparation for the event. Other area organizations will be participating as well. Candy donations are being accepted at the welcome desk through Sunday, October the 26th. The deacons are hosting a collection drive for the Noma Hygiene Closet now through the month of October. There is a collection bin next to the welcome desk where you can place your items. You may also leave a monetary donation instead if you would like. The missions committee will meet on Tuesday, October 8th at 10 a.m. in the parlor. Trustees will be meeting on Wednesday, October the 9th at 7 a.m. And the deacons' meeting will be Tuesday, October the 15th at 10 in the parlor. Our November forecaster submission deadline is Tuesday, October the 22nd. And I thank you for your kindness and patience with me as I share those announcements. But as you can see, we are a thriving church, and to share all the good news is actually an honor for me. So let's start our worship today. Let's take a breath and move away from all of the details for the moment and focus on why we're here. Let us start by joining together in our call to worship. Today we gather to praise God for the steadfast love which helps us walk faithfully.
We rejoice and eagerly come to bless the Lord.
This is a day to sing a song of thanksgiving, to tell of God's wondrous deeds.
We trust God to redeem us.
Our faith leads us to bless God today and every day.
Even as we celebrate our covenant commitment to be followers of Jesus the Christ.
Amen and amen. Our opening hymn today is on the next page. As we gather at your table, number 314, please stand if you are able. Celebrate today, grateful for the opportunity to have to worship you in word, in song, and through connection at the table. What a gift it is to gather with others, to offer our praise and to receive the gifts of bread and cup which bind us together to you. In this time of worship, fill us with joy as we offer you the best we have. May we tap into our little child identity so our enthusiasm bubbles over as we worship. Amen and amen. And now is our time of sharing of the peace. May the peace of God be with you and yours.
But also with you.
Thank you so much. And now we may greet one another in peace. Thinking this day and age, with all that goes on in the world, you know, to share the peace here is so very important. What I do is I actually hold everyone in my heart, people who are not here and people in the world. So, Linda, peace. Let us share our statement of oneness. We are made in the image of God. Thus, as we grow in faith and mature in spirit, that image shall shine all the more clearly. Like Jesus, we are children of God. Thus, as our birthright, we shall live all our days surrounded by unconditional love.
Humanity, the image of God, is beautiful in God's sight, part of a magnificent creation. Therefore, we are beautiful in God's eyes. The scriptures declare that the entire kingdom of God is within us. Also, we live our lives immersed in divinity. We gather to celebrate that sacred and wondrous truth. Many hurtful and unjust things happen in our world, motivated by hatred or fear. Yet also there is love in our hearts. Let us declare that love, acknowledge it as of God, and promise to grow in love. Day by day.
Amen.
There's a presence moving softly in the quiet of my being, calling softly all the time. One heart, one
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Our first reading today is from Psalm 8. Our Lord, our Sovereign, how majestic is your name in all of the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouths of babes and infants you have founded a bulwark because of your foes, to silence the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established, what are humans that you are mindful of them, mortals that you care for them? Yet you have made them a little lower than God, and crowned them with glory and honor. You have given them dominion over the works of their hands. You have put all things under their feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Sovereign, how majestic is your name in all of the truth, the word of God.
Please rise as you're able for our gospel reading for today. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter, beginning with the second verse. Some, testing Jesus, asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" He answered them, "What did Moses command you?" They said, Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her. But Jesus said to them, because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. Then in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. He said to them, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if he divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery. People were bringing children to him in order that he might touch them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, let the children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly, I tell you. And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. The word of God. We haven't had a children's Sunday school in quite a few years. There just haven't been children who are regularly a part of worship. It's hard to prepare a Sunday school lesson only to have no kids show up. But churches handle the presence of children differently. Some provide a children's sermon during worship. Others shuffle the children off to a Sunday school right out of the worship service. And yet others have a children's choir. Today's gospel reading doesn't start off with the children, but I'm glad it ends with it. Today's gospel reading starts off with a complicated discussion of divorce. Divorce is never easy. Hebrew law had specifics of the conditions under which the divorce would be granted. But all of our focus on divorce leads us astray from the primary point of the gospel. Once again, that point is about relationships. It takes a relationship to have a marriage, and relationships are needed to have children. Whether they're naturally born to the family or whether they're adopted. It takes relationships to have a church and a community. David Loos, in his column, In the Meantime, says, reminds us that to be broken isn't to be something to be ashamed of. Rather, to be broken is, in fact, to be human. To be human is to be loved by God and drawn together into relationship with all the others that God loves. Which means that our gatherings on Sunday are local gatherings of the broken and loved, of those who are hurting but also healing, of those who are lost but have also been found, of those that know their need and seek not simply to have those needs met, but realized that in helping meet the needs of others, their own are met in turn. To meet the needs of our community, our community of faith, yes, but our community around us. And the presence of NOMA on this campus reminds us how broad our community really is.
It includes people we don't even know. It includes people who may not even share our same faith, but they have a common need, a need to be recognized, a need to be acknowledged, a need to live in community, and a place to have their needs met. Carolyn Lewis from Luther Seminary writes these words: "While we would, and our culture does, like to assert that independence is the highest form of individuality, autonomy, and a pinnacle mark of leadership, God tells us it's the opposite. We think that we are capable of a kind of independence that presupposes a selective dependence. We pretend that we don't really need anyone. We can do this on our own." Yeah. The truth is that we can't do it all on our own. We need each other. We need community. And part of that community is seen whenever we celebrate communion. On this World Communion Sunday, we celebrate the sacrament in ways that aren't shared by all churches. Here at First Congregational Church, all are welcome. We are welcome to come to the table. You don't have to believe in certain ways or doctrines or dogmas. You don't even have to belong to any church. We simply ask that you come seeking Jesus, that you join with this community today in that first communion. Jesus took bread with those, get this, who denied him, and the one who betrayed him. But Jesus broke bread nonetheless. He broke bread, and the broken community and all partook of that sacrament. Back at the gospel at hand, despite the Pharisees wanting to trap Jesus in legal consequences, Jesus maintains both concerns of a woman and those of children. Back then, children were not highly regarded, except for the males who could further the family line, and thus their lineage is often traced in our sacred scriptures. Women back then were fully reliant on their husbands for housing and food, and even for their reputation in the community. As we consider our community life together, we should also learn to rely on each other. It's what it means to be in community. We approach this by considering both marriage and divorce. John Leonard Z, in his column, Law and Gospel, writes this: "For Jesus, the real question is not whether the divorce is allowable, but what is marriage? Yes, the law of Moses allows for divorce, but this is only because of, quote unquote, your hardness of heart. In other words, it was a concession to human weakness. Better to look at God's purpose for marriage in the beginning." And Jesus quotes the immortal words from Genesis: "God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh." Jesus uses these words to define the essential nature of marriage. "So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." This message today is going to come to people who have been through marriage, some who are single, some whose marriage has been redefined by the Supreme Court, and those who have been divorced, sometimes divorced and remarried. But the message comes to us nonetheless. My parents were married for a little more than 53 years. Home back then was a secure place. Even through those patches of disagreements, we enjoyed a sense of community with one another. We had a sense of community with both church and school, too. It can be like that today. We can care for the children. We can care for the handicapped and the outcasts. We can care even for those who have no home. Hear these words from the gospel again. People were bringing children to him in order that he might touch them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the children come to me. Do not stop them. For it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms. He laid his hands on them and blessed them. It doesn't say be childlike in your faith. It says to receive the kingdom of God as a little child would. The word "would" is my addition to the text. It's saying, be as welcoming and accepting as a little child. Receive what God has given you with open arms, welcoming it and embracing it, just as Jesus embraced the children. Our challenge is to receive the kingdom not like a child, but as a trusting little child. To be community with one another. To be embracing of that community with one another, just as a child would with open arms. To be community to each other and beyond. That is the faith that is First Congregational Church. Let it be so for each of us this day. Let it be so for each of us this day. In Jesus' name, amen. We turn to our hymn. Let us talents and tongues employ. It's a good communion song. On World Communion Sunday, I invite you to rise as you're able as we sing together.
Shout of joy, bread is broken, the wine is... word around those I've found. Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again, pass the word
those I've found. Amen. Please be seated. As our ushers prepare to pass the offering plates, hear these words of our invitation to generosity today. The disciples wanted the children to go away, but Jesus gave the children his best with a blessing. Jesus blesses us too with a seat at the table and a place in his heart. Let us give God our best as we present our offerings today. Amen.
Thank you.
join me in our prayer of dedication and thanksgiving? Ever-giving God, you gave us Jesus to the world, holding nothing back. As he lived, Jesus gave to the world, holding nothing back. Thank you for this opportunity for us to give. Now, as we present this offering, God, challenge us to stretch out of our comfort zone as we plan ahead to give without holding back in all parts of our lives. In Christ we pray. Amen. Please be seated. This is the time when we share together our joys and our concerns. We will bring the microphone to you.
Good morning, everyone. A few weeks ago, there was an announcement made that I had surgery. It went well. I want to thank everybody for their thoughts and prayers. I hope everybody has a wonderful day today.
First of all, welcome back, Angelina. So good to have you with us. I'd like continuing prayers for my friend Rose and her daughter Jenny, as this problem will never end because Jenny's mentally ill and not doing well. So I just, and Rose and I went to high school together. So I continue to be concerned for her welfare and for her family's. Talking about anniversaries, my birthday was September 25th, but it also, I was born on my parents' 8th wedding anniversary. So even though my parents have been gone since 2001 and 2005, now they're on the wall as far as I'm concerned. They're the angel, part of the angels, along with Effie's father. So anyway, I always hold them up at that time. And I'm grateful, even though I am divorced, that my ex-husband and I are very, very good friends. Yesterday, I took a drive out east into Delaware County, where the leaves are about two weeks ahead of ours. So, and I drove to the reservoir. So I have a lot of gratitude for my 14-year-old car that it made the trip. Although this morning when I got in my car, the tire gauge light went on. I thought, well, that was nice. Then it waited until today for that to have that happen. But I'm glad that cars go farther than they used to. So I'm very grateful that I have a mode of transportation and that I can offer other people help sometimes. And then I just like prayers for all people caught up in addiction and their families. Thanks.
Yesterday was such a beautiful day. I saw my neighbor next door doing some yard work, and I just came over to chat with him, and he looked very sad. And he said, Barb, my sister passed away. Her name was Carol Ann Conrad, and she lived at Fairview. And I just couldn't believe it. You know, she and I have birthdays together in December, and every year we kind of get together and share things. And I just like, you know, we get close to people and then they're gone. And it's like, and he said she would call me 2 or 3 times a day. They lived together next door to me, and now he doesn't have that friendly voice coming, asking him what he had for dinner or whatever. Just small talk, but it's just a familiar voice of someone that loved you. And he was starting to tear up, and I was starting to tear up, and I said, I loved her too. But that's the thing, it's hard to let go of our loved ones.
Good morning. I was thinking of a song by the group Rush, and it's called Territories. And that song talks about warring of some kind, whether it's personal or wars or power struggles. And it's interesting because I used to do precana for the Catholic churches, for the marriages. And I was trained in that, and then I would serve people their meals and dinners as they got engaged, and they also went through the program, the pre-marriage program. And so I was thinking of that song, you know, we all have personal struggles and powers, but the one thing that I learned that was so important is that there's always going to be those eternal slights, whether they're friends or people you love. And I learned that it's eternally forgiveness that, you know, strengthens people and their bonds together, and to soften with one another and to love one another. But the song that Rush did on Territories is an interesting pickup on life and even personal relationships. So I invite you to just listen to it. And it's interesting that way back when, people were writing incredible songs about all sorts of things. So I love all the old folk songs, and it's still happening today. All of these songs are still very relevant. And I also want to bless all the people that are going through their own personal tragedies with our weather. And I often wonder if we had more peace within us, if there wouldn't be less anomalies with comets and asteroids and all sorts of things we're going through now. It kind of reflects all the wars and everything as well. So I pray for inner peace for all of us. Thank you.
Okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious and loving God, as we come to you this day, we do so as a thankful people, thankful for your many blessings to us, thankful for leaves that fall even as they turn beautiful colors, thankful for an environment in which we can breathe the air and sense your presence. We pray that you would help us to show appreciation for your environment, for your creation, doing all that we can to preserve what you have so marvelously made. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray, O God, for those children who are in school. We pray for the teachers as well, but we pray for the children that they would go through each day knowing that they are learning and that they will return to their homes safe and secure. We pray you, O God, to be a hedge of protection around them, to help them to learn with peace of mind, and to know that they are loved. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray, O God, for those who are in need of your healing touch. We pray for those who are in our minds and in our hearts, and we lift them before you aloud together in prayer. Timothy. Doug. Judy. AJ. Jesus, we know that you are the great physician, and you are with but a word able to bring healing and wholeness for all for whom we pray. And so we trust them in your loving hands, O God, as we pray together, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray as our Lord Jesus has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Sacrament of Holy Communion. Especially on this World Communion Sunday, we recognize the table does extend globally from our doorsteps to the ends of the earth. From Austin to Yuma, from Austria to Zambia, from Zanzibar right back to Alberta. Let us sing our consecration, blessing the table and inviting each other to take our place at the table to partake of the body and blood of Christ. Amen. On the night you were betrayed, you took the bread. After giving thanks, you broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you." And as you eat it, remember me. This is my body, broken for you. And as you eat it, remember me. On the night you were betrayed, you took the cup. After giving thanks, you lifted it up. This is my blood poured out for you. And as you drink it, remember me. This is my blood poured out for you. And as you thank you for the wine and for the bread. For we see the life you gave and the blood you shed. And we remember your wondrous love. You gave your body, you shed your blood. And we remember your wondrous love. You gave your body, you shed your blood. And we remember your wondrous love. You gave your body, you shed your blood. And we proclaim the mystery of the faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ shall come again. Come to the table. The feast is prepared for you. Come partake. The presence of Christ is in this sacred meal.
At FCC, we offer wine, it's a red wine, and then the white in the individual cups is grape juice, just grape juice, not wine. And we have both bread in the two large bowls and gluten-free for those who need that. And we ask that you would come, all are welcome here at this table. Again, you don't have to be a member of this church or of any church in order to receive Christ's presence in this Holy Supper. We ask that you would come, receive your bread and your cup, and then return to your seat so that we may consume it together. Body of Christ broken for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. I invite you to rise as you're able as we sing together our closing hymn. May the Lord's face shine on you and be gracious unto you.
May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen.